The nonprofit Tat Foundation was created in 1973 to bring spiritual seekers and finders together. We publish books, videos, and a free online newsletter. We maintain a website of spiritual resources and hold 4 spiritual retreat weekends each year. Our goal is to offer practical guidance for following a spiritual path and living a spiritual life. For more information, go to tatfoundation.org. That's tatfoundation.org.
So before I get started, it's been bugging me. I wanted to say something about the blurb on the TAT website for the meeting regarding how there's no hope for you. That comment was really in response to a specific individual. They wrote something, I don't remember what it was, and that's what it evoked in me. And the idea behind it was akin to Pullian's words, nothing of you will remain. So, ultimately there has to be some transcendence of identity, ego, and an inept attempt on my part to knock the person reading those words off center and challenge them that, there's no hope for you. You're all ego-driven. What you're after, there's no hope. And where would that leave you? What would you do? And when I read it, just kind of like standalone on the website, I thought, this is not for everybody. It's for a mature seeker. Somebody could read that, and you need hope. Your entire life is an expression of hope. That the living of your life is you can't live without hope. You're hoping that you can become the person you want to be and have the life you want, and you're born with that. It really comes from a place that precedes you. So that's all I want to say about that. And since this is Sunday morning, I decided I'd like to do a Sunday service. So we're going to have music and song. But first, one last detail. I need to get the Okay, I'm ready now. Yeah, my dream come true. So I think I'll just go ahead and start with the song. I was vacillating between talking about definitions momentarily, but let's just jump to this song.
To Canaan's land, I'm on my way, where the soul never dies. My darkest night will turn to day, where the soul of man never dies. No sad farewells, no tear-dimmed eyes, where all is peace and joy and love, and the soul of man never dies. The roses bloom in there for me, where the soul never dies, and I will spend eternity where the soul never dies. No sad farewells, no tear-dimmed eyes, where all is peace and joy and love, and the soul of man never dies. Love light beams across the foam where the soul never dies. It shines and lights the way to home where the soul never dies. No
Skaggs and Rice, Ricky Skaggs and Tony Rice, are bluegrass artists. When I lived in the Washington, D.C. area with Doran, we were both trying to stop the feedback. So that was Skaggs and Rice, Ricky Skaggs and Tony Rice. They're a bluegrass band, obviously. And I got into bluegrass when I lived in the D.C. area. Doran and I both really enjoyed it. And every Sunday they had a show called Stained Glass Bluegrass. And it was just fun to listen to. I thought it occurred to me to play that song at this session because spirituality is one of those words. It's like God. Does anybody actually know what it means to be spiritual? You know, what is spiritual about you? What's a spiritual life? And I don't know how you could separate your worldly life from your spiritual life. You only have one life, and I guess it comes down to where is your attention, which life are you feeding? You know, they talk about food for the soul, or food for the body, poison for the soul, that sort of thing. So I think this song is representative of a common concept of, you know, people. You know, whether you subscribe to specific religious dogma, Christian dogma, people have the idea that there's something spiritual about them and they possess it. And you can use the word soul as the tag word to denote that. So people believe that they have a soul, but it's some transcendent principle about them, but it's something that they can stain or grow. And I know all of us we had beliefs, well, not all of us, but many of us had beliefs like that when we were younger, and we outgrew them, and we have much loftier beliefs about self-inquiry and meditation and spiritual path that we're going to find something called enlightenment. But it, for myself, I saw at a late stage in my life that I really never evolved past those childhood religious beliefs. They just took on new forms, and that it came down to I really believed I was going to acquire something, okay? And no matter how many times you hear that the spiritual path is subtractive, you know, turning away from the false, finding out about yourself what is true, you can't escape the fact that you, your egocentric position is all about adding something to you, acquiring it. You're going to have experience. You're going to get enlightened. And that's what that earlier phrase about there's no hope for you, where would that leave you? I don't know how useful it is for somebody to read those words. But the fact remains is that there's something about you that intersects with something that's real and eternal, and that's what's spiritual about you. It's fun to get into definition, so I did want to mention the dictionary definitions of some of these words. It's kind of fun. So spirituality is of, relating to, consisting of, or affecting the spirit. Okay, so I looked up spirit. An animating or vital principle held to give life to physical organisms. Soul, the spiritual principle embodied in human beings or the universe. So it's something embodied, we contain it. So then I looked up soul, and it's the immaterial essence, animating principle, or actuating cause of an individual life. The spiritual principle embodied in human beings. So it's all circular, and this always happens when you go to the dictionary to look up these words. It's humorous, but so the first reading I have is a bit of writing that I found. I was flipping through my spontaneity folder, and I found this bit of writing from August 2008. I almost didn't remember writing it until I read it a couple times, and then there was a second piece to it. But anyway, what is a soul? Words for a dying Christian believer. You do not know what death is. You only know that you are now alive. How do you know this? How do you know that you are now alive? Some part of you sees your own life, all of life, life itself. If you can see and know your own aliveness, then something about you, that which sees and knows, must be outside of you just as much as it is inside you. That part of you that sees and knows you are alive can only do so if it lived both inside yourself and outside yourself. That alive something outside of you that sees and knows you, that contains you, is the soul. You do not have a soul, the soul has you. That something that sees you from the outside must not rely on your aliveness or your sight. Something that transcends your aliveness must be unborn and undying and therefore eternal. Something that exists both inside and outside of self cannot be located and is therefore everywhere. Something that can see and know from outside of you and independent of you is all-seeing and all-knowing. That which is alive, eternal, everywhere, all-seeing and all-knowing is God. If your own seeing and knowing of yourself and that you are alive is this, then you cannot be separate from God. You are not the mortal body. You are not the mortal mind. You are the unborn and undying eternal soul. You are God. The question is, why don't you see this? It's available to you. You're always looking at something. And I see that when you're looking at something, you are simultaneously looking at what you are, but you're blinded to it. The focus of your attention is on swirling events, the stream of experience, and how it, confirms your own identity, your own existence. You could say in a way that you're always staring at yourself. You're always looking at a mirror, because the mirror of experience, the whole stream of experience is reflecting you to yourself. So I see that when you're looking at things, because this power of seeing does not belong to you, doesn't emanate from you as you define yourself, it precedes you. So when you're looking at yourself, even in the external dream, you're really looking at your core source of being. It, And maybe that doesn't really do anybody any good, but that's what's arising right now in my spontaneous word machinery, so I'm going to go with that. I want to read one other piece of that. I wrote a different variation of that, and it was titled Words for a Dying Christian Doubter. Christ wrote, "The light of the body is the eye. If, therefore, thine eye be pure, then thy whole body will be filled with light." The light in the body is that which sees. There's another version of this writing of his where he says the eye is the light of the body. And in the Bible, it's I think it's spelled with the letter I, at least the version of the Bible I have. But if you just think about it, it's like, well, that which sees, it's not the ego, it's the eye, that which sees. So anyway, the light in the body is that which sees. That which sees must be behind or outside of that which is seen. Therefore, that in you that knows you are alive is at the same time something that is outside of you, and therefore something that will remain after your death. There's a lot of therefores in here. If, therefore, you see only what you are, then you will see only that light. Therefore, the body is not you. Rather, you are that light. You are that which enlivens and animates the body. Therefore, the body is dependent on your real being. Your real being is not dependent on the body or the mind. This idea that the mind is separate from the body is false. It's an illusion. It's a belief or an outgrowth of the stream of experience. But it goes with the body. You know, the idea that the soul, the words in that song, they're so egocentric. I will spend eternity. And, you know, I'm this, and it's all from a personal-based point of view. And can you imagine if you lived, think of the best version you could possibly think of yourself. And then you're going to keep living for a gazillion, zillion, 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 zillion years. I mean, that sounds like hell to me. What is eternal, it's not even logical that it would be, you know, the resurrected body or, you know, the individuality. So the conclusion of these words for a dying Christian doubter, in every moment, waking or sleeping, you have a sense of existing and a sense of self. This is what you are watching and seeing always. Everything else seen is a distraction from this core. You are that which is seeing. This seeing originates outside of and beyond the body-mind. The body-mind contains the personality. You are not that which dies. Small comfort if you don't know, you know, you don't know that, and you haven't, I mean, that part of it is really inexplicable and a paradox. In my own experience, I was just obsessed with this idea. It's like, who saw his own non-existence? You know, I mean, I'm aware as this this embodied soul, to use the current session language, and yet I saw that I was nothing, and that there was nothing to die, and that I was everything. And well, who saw that? Well, you know, I've heard cliches in the literature, in the non-dual literature. Well, it was God seeing himself and God revealing himself to himself. And, you know, the follow on from that is they say, you are already that which you seek. I don't think any of that is helpful, but, you know, maybe my words aren't any more helpful. I'm not sure. I have another reading, but I'm going to pause for a moment and see if anyone has any comment or question that may have arisen.
In relation to what you were just saying and the paradox there, it reminds me of an aspect of the quote that you mentioned at the beginning of this talk that you wanted to clarify. And one of the lines in that quote was, "You will live and die in ignorance." If there is a realization, I mean, is that still a true statement?
It's an inept attempt to state a paradox. But the part that's true is that your body will, from dust were you made, until dust shall you return, and that includes the mind. The mind is at all times one with the body. So the personality, the ego, that's gonna die and perish and be gone. So that person isn't gonna be around to have the thought and ask themselves the question, who is it that saw my own non-existence? That part of you is gone, but that's perfectly okay once you know you've been resting in the arms of God and are holding yourself. When you know you are the eternal, permanent, impersonal, it doesn't matter that the personal is impermanent. Yeah, I'll go ahead and read this other reading, because actually I have a reading from the a psalm that I also want to read, but I'd like to read this next piece first. I'm sorry. Oh, your Art's head was blocking. Art was the penny blocking the sun back there.
Radama has said to me, asked me this a couple of times, do I see any difference between psychological inquiry versus spiritual inquiry? And then sometimes she talks about, inquiry to the smallest self versus the largest self. I haven't given her a definitive answer, but do you have any take on
it? Well, where they over...
Do we see the overlap?
Where they overlap is the inward direction of the looking, but a kind of a stop and distraction along the way, maybe it could be, is where you start to get into the weeds about how your machinery is working. But on the other hand, sometimes that's the entry point. That's how you turn the attention inward, because it's this idea that just follow the I am. Like in Nisargadatta, I've read those words, just follow the I am. And Ramana Maharshi talks about the who am I question. And I could never do that. I mean, it always felt like, okay, you think you're going to sit down and meditate. And I'm not saying don't try. It could have value, perhaps. But it didn't work for me. Sit down and think, okay, who am I? Who am I? Where am I coming from? You're so locked in and laminated to this personality identity. It's what you're always looking from that point of view. So you're not gonna. I don't think that's gonna work. It didn't work for me. I think what Rose advocated and what I think ultimately worked for me was, you ask the who am I question obliquely. Because everything that happens in your life that throws you back on yourself, which is, it's almost never hard to imagine how it could ever be pleasurable, joyful experiences. Nobody wins the lottery and goes home and thinks, geez, I just won $10 million. What's the purpose of my life? What's the meaning of my life? I mean, maybe they would. I don't know. But it's doubtful. But when they... experience the death of something close to them, a family member or even a pet, or they go through a personal hardship, a divorce, or they get unexpectedly fired from their job, or they have an unpleasant argument. All those things make us reflective, self-reflective. And then the robot programming and the overwhelming momentum of a lifetime of habit is to, it maybe in a instant moment you've turned around and you're like staring directly into that sense of self and who am I and what just got injured or something, you know, but you immediately spin it outward and you start having an argument and you know, with the person you were arguing with, all the things you could have, should have said, and you know, yada yada. We all know how that works, and almost everybody here has heard me repeat this notion over and over again that meditating on conflict, trauma, I use the tagline afflictions to the sense of self, is the way you ask the question, who am I? So that's the big end, the small self-inquiry, I guess, that Arnim is pointing to. So this is more recent. This is from January 2020, and it was in the forum. I don't know, maybe you read it or not, but it's over two years old anyway. And it started with a quote from the stage manager in Thornton Wilder's play, Our Town. And he says, the stage manager says, there's something way down deep that's eternal about every human being. And so I wrote this little essay. I'll go ahead and read it. The stage manager speaks the truth, albeit in a folksy manner consistent with his character in the play. He says, down deep, to suggest that this eternal something is hidden from or out of ordinary view of most everyone. Something eternal would have to be unborn and undying. Rather than describing this eternal something as way down deep, I'd rather describe it as all-pervading and ever-present, surrounding and enveloping every human being. Indeed, it permeates all things. We do not contain it, but are contained within it. It does not arise from us, but we from it. It is the source of the power we call attention that we claim as ours. That attention is that attention of ours is focused on objects, starting with the body, and from there, all the experiences of that body, and from there, to an experience of being the owner of that body, a persona, an identity, albeit a fickle chameleon-like identity, that talks to itself in a multitude of different voices, stemming from a multitude of different desires, and reacting to a stream of experience. That stream of experience is a stage play, and that attention that we could call ours is lost in that play. One does not get to it, or travel to it, or acquire that eternal something. One realizes it as one's very being. And the truth of that is why such realization is even possible. So the question is, what brings about this realization? This realization occurs when the focus of the attention turns wholly upon itself and not on any external object. So what is the object of your attention? You are always looking at something. Don't kid yourself that you can stop looking at something. What are you looking at in any given moment? Do you even see that clearly? What clouds you're seeing? Do you see what is, or what you want to see? Whatever you see is in your view and therefore is not you, so where are you looking from? By questioning what you see and how you are seeing it, you are shifting the object of your attention in an internal direction. When that internal direction of looking reaches a momentum that cannot be diminished by pleasure or pain, or deflected outward by fear or desire, or interrupted by self-centered thoughts, then realization of that eternal something will manifest. The best catalyst for this questioning is viewing afflictions to one's sense of self. So do not look away from those, break that habit. These are everything that induce so-called negative emotions or unwanted emotions. A secondary thing to look at is what motivates you. What is responsible for your doing the things that you do, especially those things that are not self-consistent. things that contradict your declared commitments, whatever they may be, or contradict the character you imagine you are and want others to believe that you are. Thirdly, you need to act. Action has an impact upon the attention. You need to see yourself in action and manifest your commitment and understanding, not merely imagine it. Your commitment being you feel this desire coming, welling up in you that you want to know yourself, you want to go home, you want the truth, and then you declare to yourself a commitment. You know, Tara mentioned the striving to be consistent in thought, word, and deed. Thought was her intention. I want to do this. And she affirms it to herself, and then she needs to act on it. And that's what I'm talking about. When you wake up from the dream, that eternal something about you will be seen as neither inside or outside you, but rather inseparable and indistinguishable from your true self. So I'll pause a bit, and then I'll play my next music piece. Some of you heard me mention this, but along the lines of what I just said, in the beginning of my search, when I tried to practice the meditation that Rose recommended, which was to think of something from your past, look at past traumas. He used the phrase past traumas, because you couldn't really look at a current trauma. If you even understood it to be a trauma, it would be too hot. You would just end up reliving it. And, you know, just, you know, repeating it in your imagination. So it was past trauma. So my meditation would be sit down, do a few, you know, a couple minute or two of some breathing exercises to quiet the body down, prepare for a period of sitting. And then I would say a little prayer to myself, which was, Father, bless me that I might see clearly. You know, I was about to look at something, and I wanted to see it as it was, because I understood that I was deluding myself. And by definition, you don't know what you don't know. So bless me that I might see clearly. Grace me that I might understand. I needed a higher power to, like, let me actually understand what I was seeing. It's not enough to just see something as an objective bystander. You had to understand, it had to bring some understanding to you. And the third thing was, strengthen me that I might live my understanding. I sensed or knew that, well, if you understand something, there's an imperative that you do something with it. You know, especially when it involves your personal life, you have to act on it. If you don't, then you're going to be stuck there. You can't move on. All right, for the next piece, I'm not sure if you like that first one. Maybe you hate bluegrass. I can't imagine anybody not just loving these songs. They're just come on. And this next one, I think you'll like this one. It's called "The Old Crossroads." It was written by Bill Monroe, who's one of the founding fathers of bluegrass, and
oh, my brother, take this warning. Don't let old Satan hold your hand. You'll be lost in sin forever. You'll never reach the promised land. The old crossroad now is waiting. Which one are you gonna take? One leads down to destruction. The other to the pearly gate. leads up to heaven. The other goes down below. Jesus, our Savior, will protect you. He'll guide you by the old crossroad. The old crossroad now is waiting. Which one are you gonna take? One leads down to destruction. The other to the pearly gate. You have to face the old crossroad. Will you be ready then, my brother, to shun the one goes down below? The old crossroad now is waiting. Which one are you gonna take? One leads down to the other to the pearly gate.
One verse in there that I highlighted, you may have not heard the last line. Soon your life will be over. You'll have to face the old crossroad. Will you be ready then, my brother, to shun the one that goes down below? I hear lyrics like this or read things, and I often see a double meaning in them. They have an intended kind of common conventional meaning, and I read more into them. And to shun the one that goes down below, that's the mortal impermanent part of you. That's the part of you. It's not, they're talking about the devil. You know, going down to hell. You got to shun the Satan in this life. But, you know, maybe you're your own Satan. All right, I'm seeing that we're almost running out of time, and there's one last reading I don't want to not read. This is Psalm 139, and it's from the Episcopal Book of Common Prayer, page 794. And the first time I heard this at the church service, it brought tears to my eyes. And over the years, when I pulled it out and would read it, it would always really hit me hard. So I hope that doesn't happen now, because I want to read it well. And this is one of those pieces of writings that, you know, I would say you hear about direct teaching, the direct teachers. Well, their direct words are often quite clumsy and too literal, and, you know, these words are very deep and subtle. Lord, you have searched me out and known me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You trace my journeys and my resting places and are acquainted with all my ways. Indeed, there is not a word on my lips, but you, O Lord, know it all together. You press upon me from behind and before and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain to it. Where can I go then from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I climb up to heaven, you are there. If I make the grave my bed, you are there also. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand will lead me and your right hand hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will cover me and the light around me turn to night. Darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day. Darkness and light to you are both alike. Thank you all for coming. Well, and if you look it up on the internet, I stuck with this one. I clipped this from the church bulletin from all those years ago, and I looked it up on the internet, and some of the other phrasings in other Bibles just don't have the same poetic quality. This is 139, page 794, Episcopal Book of Common Prayer.